A Theologico-Political Treatise, Tractatus Theologico-Politicus, by Baruch, later Benedicta, Spinoza, translated by Robert Harvey Munro Elwes, read by Leighton Pugh, for Ukemi Audiobooks. A Theologico-Political Treatise, containing certain discussions, wherein is set forth that freedom of thought and speech not only may, without prejudice to piety and the public peace, be granted, but also may not, without danger to piety and the public peace, be withheld. Introduction by R. H. W. Elwes, 1883. Until the end of the 19th century, the writings of Baruch or Benedict of Spinoza, 1632 to 1677, known in Europe, were little known in the UK. At first sight, this tardy recognition may seem less surprising than the preceding apathy, for history can show few figures more remarkable than the solitary thinker of Amsterdam. But the causes which kept Spinoza in comparative obscurity are not very far to seek. Personally, he shrank from anything like notoriety. His chief work was withheld till after his death, and then published anonymously. His treatise on religion was also put forth in secret, and he disclaims with evident sincerity all desire to found a school or give his name to a sect. Again, the form in which his principal work is cast is such as to repel those dilettante readers whose suffrage is necessary for a widely extended reputation. None but genuine students would care to grapple with the serried array of definitions, axioms, and propositions of which the ethics is composed, while the display of geometric accuracy flatters the careless into supposing that the whole structure is interdependent, and that when a single breach has been effected, the entire fabric has been demolished. The matter, no less than the manner, of Spinoza's writings was such as to preclude popularity. He genuinely shocked his contemporaries. Advances in thought are tolerated in proportion as they respond to and, as it were, kindle into flame ideas which are already smouldering obscurely in many minds. A teacher may deepen, modify, transfigure what he finds, but he must not attempt radical reconstruction. In the 17th century, all men's deepest convictions were inseparably bound up with anthropomorphic notions of the deity. Spinoza, in attacking these latter and endeavouring to substitute the conception of eternal and necessary law, seemed to be striking at the very roots of moral order. Hence, with curious irony, his works, which few read and still fewer understood, became associated with notions of monstrous impiety, and their author, who loved virtue with single-hearted and saintly devotion, was branded as a railer against God and a subverter of morality, whom it was a shame even to speak of. Those from whom fairer views might have been expected swelled the popular cry. The Cartesians sought to confirm their own precarious reputation for orthodoxy by emphatic disavowals of their more daring associate. Leibniz, who had known Spinoza personally, speaks of him, whether from jealousy or some more avowable motive, in tones of consistent depreciation. The torrent of abuse which poured forth from the theologians and their allies served to overwhelm the ethical and metaphysical aspect of Spinoza's teaching. The philosopher was hidden behind the arch-heretic. Throughout almost the whole of the century following his death, he is spoken of in terms displaying complete misapprehension of his importance and scope. The grossly inaccurate account given by Bayle in the Dictionnaire Philosophique was accepted as sufficient. The only symptom of a following is found in the religious sect of Hatomists, which based some of its doctrines on an imperfect understanding of the so-called mystic passages in the Ethics. The first real recognition came from Gotthold Lessing, who found in Spinoza a strength and solace he sought in vain elsewhere, though he never accepted the system as a whole. His conversation with Friedrich Jacobi, 1780, a diligent though hostile student of the Ethics, may be said to mark the beginning of a new epoch in the history of Spinozism. Attention once attracted was never again withdrawn, and received a powerful impulse from Goethe, who more than once confessed his indebtedness to the ethics, which indeed is abundantly evident throughout his writings. Schleiermacher paid an eloquent tribute to the holy, the rejected Spinoza. Novalis celebrated him as the man intoxicated with deity, der gottvertrunkene Mann, and Heine for once forgot to sneer as he recounted his life. The brilliant novelist Auerbach not only translated his complete works, but also made his history the subject of a biographical romance. Among German philosophers, Kant is perhaps the last who shows no traces of Spinozism. Hegel has declared that to be a philosopher, one must first be a Spinozist. Even towards the end of the 19th century, Spinoza was, in France, still viewed as a disciple and perverter of Descartes. In England, the first recognition of his true character came probably from Germany through Coleridge, who in his desultory way expressed enthusiastic admiration and recorded his opinion in a pencil note to a passage in Schelling that the ethics, the Novum Organum, and the Critique of Pure Reason were the three greatest works written since the introduction of Christianity. The influence of Spinoza has been traced in Wordsworth, and it is on record that Shelley not only contemplated, but began a translation of the Tractatus Theologico-Politicus to be published with a preface by Lord Byron, but the project was cut short by his death. It is said that George Eliot left behind at her decease a manuscript translation of the Ethics. It may strike those who are strangers to Spinoza as curious that notwithstanding the severely abstract nature of his method, so many poets and imaginative writers should be found among his adherents. Lessing, Goethe, Heine, Auerbach, Coleridge, Shelley, George Eliot, most of these not only admired him, but studied him deeply. On closer approach, the apparent anomaly vanishes. There is about Spinoza a power and a charm which appeals strongly to the poetic sense. He seems to dwell among heights which most men see only in far-off momentary glimpses. The world of men is spread out before him. The workings of the human heart lie bared to his gaze, but he does not fall to weeping or to laughter or to reviling. His thoughts are ever with the eternal, and something of the beauty and calm of eternal things has passed into his teaching. If we may, as he himself was wont to do, interpret spiritually a Bible legend, we may say of him that, like Moses returning from Sinai, he bears in his presence the witness that he has held communion with the Most High. The main authority for the facts of Spinoza's life is a short biography by Johannes Kohlerus, Lutheran pastor at The Hague, who occupied the lodgings formerly tenanted by the philosopher. The Orthodox Christian felt a genuine abhorrence for the doctrines which he regarded as atheistic, but was honest enough to recognize the stainless purity of their author's character. He sets forth what he has to say with a quaint directness, in admirable keeping with the outward simplicity of the life he depicts. Further authentic information is obtainable from passing notices in the works of Leibniz and from Spinoza's published correspondence, though the editors of the latter have suppressed all that appear to them of merely personal interest. Baruch Spinoza was born in Amsterdam, November the 24th, 1634. His parents were Portuguese or possibly Spanish Jews, who had sought a refuge in the Netherlands from the rigours of the Inquisition in the peninsula. Though nothing positive is known of them, they appear to have been in easy circumstances, and certainly bestowed on their only son, their other two children being girls, a thorough education according to the notions of their time and sect. At the Jewish high school under the guidance of Mortera, a learned Talmudist, and possibly of the brilliant Menashe ben Israel, who afterwards, in 1655, was employed to petition from Cromwell the readmission of the Jews to England, The young Spinoza was instructed in the learning of the Hebrews, the mysteries of the Talmud and the Kabbalah, the text of the Old Testament, and the commentaries of Ibn Ezra and Maimonides. Readers of the Tractatus Theologico-Politicus will be able to appreciate the use made of this early training. Besides such severer studies, Spinoza was, in obedience to rabbinical tradition, made acquainted with a manual trade, that of lens polishing, and gained a knowledge of French, Italian and German. Spanish, Portuguese and Hebrew were almost his native tongues. But curiously enough, as we learn from one of his lately discovered letters, he wrote Dutch with difficulty. Latin was not included in the Jewish curriculum, being tainted with the suspicion of heterodoxy. But Spinoza, feeling probably that it was the key to much of the world's best knowledge, set himself to learn it, first with the aid of a German master, afterwards at the house of Franciscus van den Enden, a physician. Footnote. A translator has special opportunities for observing the extent of Spinoza's knowledge of Latin. His sentences are grammatical and his meaning almost always clear. But his vocabulary is restricted, his style is wanting in flexibility and seldom idiomatic. In fact, the niceties of scholarship are wanting. He reminds one of a clever workman who accomplishes much with simple tools. End of footnote. It is probably from the latter that he gained the sound knowledge of physical science, which so largely leavened his philosophy, and no doubt he at this time began the study of Descartes, whose reputation towered above the learned world of the period. However, the brilliant Jewish student was overtaken by that mental crisis which has come over so many lesser men before and since. The creed of his fathers was found unequal to the strain of his own wider knowledge and changed spiritual needs. The Hebrew faith, with its immemorial antiquity, its unbroken traditions, its myriads of martyrs, could appeal to an authority which no other religion has equalled, and Spinoza, as we know from a passage in one of his letters, felt the claim to the full. We may be sure that the gentle and reserved youth was in no haste to obtrude his altered views, but the time arrived when they could no longer be, with honesty, concealed. The Jewish doctors were exasperated at the defection of their most promising pupil, and endeavoured to retain him in their communion by the offer of a yearly pension of 1,000 florins. Such overtures were, of course, rejected. Sterner measures were then resorted to. It is even related, on excellent authority, that Spinoza's life was attempted as he was coming out of the Portuguese synagogue. Be that as it may, he fled from Amsterdam and was, in 1656, formally excommunicated and anathematized according to the rites of the Jewish Church. Thus isolated from his kindred, he sought more congenial society among the dissenting community of collegians, a body of men who, without priests or set forms of worship, carried out the precepts of simple piety. He passed some time in the house of one of that body, not far from Amsterdam, on the Ouderkerk Road, and in 1660, or the following year, removed with his friend to the headquarters of the sect at Rheinsberg, near Leiden, where the memory of his sojourn is still preserved in the name Spinoza Lane. His separation from Judaism was marked by his substituting for his name, Baruch, the Latin equivalent, Benedict, but he never received baptism or formally joined any Christian sect. Only once again does his family come into the record of his life. On the death of his father, his sisters endeavoured to deprive him of his share of the inheritance, on the ground that he was an outcast and heretic. Spinoza resisted their claim by law, but on gaining his suit yielded up to them all they had demanded, except one bed. Skill in polishing lenses gave him sufficient money for his scanty needs, and he acquired a reputation as an optician before he became known as a philosopher. It was in this capacity that he was consulted by Leibniz. His only contribution to the science was a short treatise on the rainbow, printed posthumously in 1687. This was long regarded as lost, but has in our own time been recovered and reprinted by Dr. van Vloten. Spinoza also drew for amusement portraits of his friends with ink or charcoal. Collerus possessed a whole book of such drafts, amongst which there were some heads of several considerable persons who were known to him or had occasion to visit him, and also a portrait of the philosopher himself in the costume of Masaniello. So remarkable a man could hardly remain obscure, and we have no reason to suppose that Spinoza shrank from social intercourse. Though in the last years of his life his habits were somewhat solitary, this may be set down to failing health, poverty, and the pressure of uncompleted work. He was never a professed ascetic, and probably, in the earlier years of his separation from Judaism, was the centre of an admiring and affectionate circle of friends. In his letters, he frequently states that visitors leave him no time for correspondence, and the tone in which he was addressed by comparative strangers shows that he enjoyed considerable reputation and respect. Before the appearance of the Tractatus Theologico-Politicus, he had published nothing which could shock the susceptibilities of Christians, and he was known to be a complete master of Cartesianism, then regarded as the consummation and crown of learning. It is recorded that a society of young men used to hold meetings in Amsterdam for the discussion of philosophical problems, and that Spinoza contributed papers as material for their debates. Possibly the manuscript treatise On God, Man and His Blessedness, which has been rediscovered in two Dutch copies during our own time, may be referred to this period. It is of no philosophic value compared with the Ethics, but is interesting historically as throwing light on the growth of Spinoza's mind and his early relations to Cartesianism. Oblivion has long since settled down over this little band of questioners, but a touching record has been preserved of one of their number, Simon de Vries, who figures in Spinoza's correspondence. He had often, we are told, wished to bestow gifts of money on his friend and master, but these had always been declined. During the illness which preceded his early death, he expressed a desire to make the philosopher his heir. This again was declined, and he was prevailed on by Spinoza to reduce the bequest to a small annuity and to leave the bulk of his property to his family. When he had passed away, his brother fixed the pension at 500 florins, but Spinoza declared the sum excessive and refused to accept more than 300 florins, which were punctually paid him till his death. Besides this instruction by correspondence, for which he seems to have demanded no payment, mischief, as one of his biographers puts it, could be had from him for nothing. Spinoza, at least in one instance, received into his house a private pupil, generally identified with one Albert Burg, who became a convert to Rome in 1675, and took that occasion to admonish his ex-tutor in a strain of contemptuous pity. Probably to this youth were dictated the principles of Cartesianism geometrically demonstrated, which Spinoza was induced by his friends to publish, with the addition of some metaphysical reflections, in 1663. Lodewijk Meyer, a physician of Amsterdam and one of Spinoza's intimates, saw the book through the press and supplied a preface. Its author does not appear to have attached any importance to the treatise, which he regarded merely as likely to pave the way for the reception of more original work. It is interesting as an example of the method afterwards employed in the Ethics, used to support propositions not accepted by their expounder. It also shows that Spinoza thoroughly understood the system he rejected. In the same year, the philosopher removed from Rheinsburg to Voorburg, a suburb of The Hague, and in 1670 to The Hague itself, where he lived till his death in 1677, lodging first in the house, afterwards tenanted by Collerus, of the widow van Velden, and subsequently with van der Spijk, a painter. He was very likely led to leave Rheinsburg by his increasing reputation and a desire for educated society. By this time he was well known in Holland and counted among his friends Johan de Witt, who is said to have consulted him on affairs of state. Nor was his fame confined to his native country. Henry Oldenburg, the first secretary of the newly established Royal Society of England, had visited him at Rheinsberg, introduced possibly by Huygens, and had invited him to carry on a correspondence in terms of affectionate intimacy. Oldenburg was rather active-minded than able, never really understood or sympathised with Spinoza's standpoint, and was thoroughly shocked at the appearance of the Tractatus Theologico-Politicus, but he was the intimate friend of Robert Boyle, and kept his correspondent acquainted with the progress of science in England. Later on, in 1671, Leibniz consulted Spinoza on a question of practical optics, and in 1676, Ludwig von Chienhausen, a Bohemian nobleman known in the history of mathematical science, contributed some pertinent criticisms on the ethics, then circulated in manuscript. In 1670, the Tractatus Theologico-Politicus was published anonymously with the name of a fictitious printer at Hamburg. It naturally produced a storm of angry controversy. It was, in 1674, formally prohibited by the States General, and, as a matter of course, was placed on the index by the Romish Church. Perhaps few books have been more often refuted or less seriously damaged by the ordeal. Its author displayed his disinclination to disturb the faith of the unlearned by preventing, during his lifetime, the appearance of the book in the vernacular. In 1672, men's thoughts were, for a time, diverted from theological controversy by the French invasion of the Netherlands and the consequent outbreak of domestic faction. The shameful massacre of the brothers de Witt by an infatuated mob brought Spinoza into close and painful contact with the passions seething round him. For once his philosophic calm was broken. He was only by force prevented from rushing forth into the streets at the peril of his life and proclaiming his abhorrence of the crime. Shortly afterwards, when the headquarters of the French army were at Utrecht, Spinoza was sent for by the Prince de Condé, who wished to make his acquaintance. On his arrival at the camp, however, he found that the prince was absent, and after waiting a few days, returned home without having seen him. The philosopher's French entertainers held out hopes of a pension from Louis XIV if a book were dedicated to that monarch, but these overtures were declined. On his arrival at The Hague, Spinoza was exposed to considerable danger from the excited populace, who suspected him of being a spy. The calm which had failed him on the murder of his friend remained unruffled by the peril threatening himself. He told his landlord, who was in dread of the house being sacked, that if the mob showed any signs of violence, he would go out and speak to them in person, though they should serve him as they had served the unhappy de Witts. "I am a good republican," he added, "and have never had any aim but the welfare and good of the state." In 1673, Spinoza was offered by the Elector Palatine, Karl Ludwig, a professorship of philosophy at Heidelberg, but declined it on the plea that teaching would interfere with his original work, and that doctrinal restrictions, however slight, would prove irksome. In the following year, the Ethics were finished and circulated in manuscript, among their author's friends. Spinoza made a journey to Amsterdam for the purpose of publishing them, but changed his intention on learning that they would probably meet with a stormy reception. Perhaps failing health strengthened his natural desire for peace, and considerations of personal renown never had any weight with him. To this closing period belong the details as to Spinoza's manner of life collected by Kolerus. They are best given in the biographer's simple words, as rendered in the contemporary English version. "It is scarce credible how sober and frugal he was. Not that he was reduced to so great a poverty as not to be able to spend more if he had been willing. He had friends enough who offered him their purses and all manner of assistance, but he was naturally very sober and would be satisfied with little. His food apparently cost him but a few pence a day, and he drank hardly any wine. He was often invited to eat with his friends, but chose rather to live upon what he had at home, though it were never so little, than to sit down to a good table at the expense of another man. He was very careful to cast up his accounts every quarter, which he did, that he might spend neither more nor less than what he could spend every year. And he would say sometimes to the people of the house that he was like the serpent, who forms a circle with his tail in his mouth, to denote that he had nothing left at the year's end. He added that he designed to lay up no more money than what would be necessary for him to have a decent burying. He was of a middle size. He had good features in his face, the skin somewhat black, black curled hair, long eyebrows, and of the same colour, so that one might easily know by his looks that he was descended from Portuguese Jews. If he was very frugal in his way of living, his conversation was also very sweet and easy. He knew admirably well how to be a master of his passions. He was never seen very melancholy nor very merry. He was, besides, very courteous and obliging. He would very often discourse with his landlady, especially when she lay in, and with the people of the house when they happened to be sick or afflicted. He never failed then to comfort them and exhort them to bear with patience those evils which God assigned to them as a lot. He put the children in mind of going often to church and taught them to be obedient and dutiful to their parents. When the people of the house came from church, he would often ask them what they had learned and what they remembered of the sermon. He had a great esteem for Dr. Cordes, my predecessor, who was a learned and good-natured man, and of an exemplary life, which gave occasion to Spinoza to praise him very often. Nay, he went sometimes to hear him preach. It happened one day that his landlady asked him whether he believed she could be saved in the religion she professed. He answered, "Your religion is a very good one. You need not look for another, nor doubt that you may be saved in it, provided, whilst you apply yourself to piety, you live at the same time a peaceable and quiet life." His amusements were very simple. Talking on ordinary matters with the people of the house, smoking now and again a pipe of tobacco, watching the habits and quarrels of insects, making observations with a microscope. Such were his pastimes in the hours which he could spare from his philosophy. But the greater part of his day was taken up with severe mental work in his own room. Sometimes he would become so absorbed that he would remain alone for 2 or 3 days together, his meals being carried up to him. Spinoza had never been robust, and had for more than 20 years been suffering from phthisis, a malady which at any rate in those days never allowed its victims to escape. The end came quite suddenly and quietly in February 1677. On Saturday the 20th, after the landlord and his wife had returned from church, Spinoza spent some time with them in conversation, and smoked a pipe of tobacco, but went to bed early. Apparently he had previously sent for his friend and physician, Ludovic Meyer, who arrived on Sunday morning. On the 21st Spinoza came down as usual, and partook of some food at the midday meal. In the afternoon the physician stayed alone with his patient, the rest going to church. But when the landlord and his wife returned, they were startled with the news that the philosopher had expired about 3 o'clock. Ludovic Meyer returned to Amsterdam that same evening. Thus passed away all that was mortal of Spinoza. If we have read his character aright, his last hours were comforted with the thought not so much that he had raised for himself an imperishable monument, as that he had pointed out to mankind a sure path to happiness and peace. Perhaps with this glorious vision there mingled the more tender feeling that among the simple folk with whom he lived, his memory would, for a few brief years, be cherished with reverence and love. The funeral took place on the 25th of February, being attended by many illustrious persons and followed by 6 coaches. The estate left behind him by the philosopher was very scanty. Rebecca de Spinoza, sister of the deceased, put in a claim as his heir, but abandoned it on finding that after the payment of expenses, little or nothing would remain. The manuscripts which were found in Spinoza's desk were, in accordance with his wishes, forwarded to Jan Riewerts, a publisher of Amsterdam, and were that same year brought out by Ludovic Meyer and another of the philosopher's friends under the title BDS Opera Posthuma. They consisted of the Ethics, a selection of letters, a compendium of Hebrew grammar, and two uncompleted treatises, one on politics, the other, styled An Essay on the Improvement of the Understanding, on logical method. The last named had been begun several years previously, but had apparently been added to from time to time. It develops some of the doctrines indicated in the Ethics, and serves in some sort as an introduction to the larger work. In considering Spinoza's system of philosophy, it must not be forgotten that the problem of the universe seemed much simpler in his day than it does in our own. Men had not then recognized that knowledge is a world whose margin fades forever and forever as we move. They believed that truth was something definite, which might be grasped by the aid of a clear head, diligence, and a sound method. Hence a tone of confidence breathed through their inquiries which has since died away, and a completeness was aimed at which is now seen to be unattainable. But the products of human thought are often valuable in ways undreamt of by those who fashion them, and long after their original use has become obsolete. A system, obviously inadequate and defective as a whole, may yet enshrine ideas which the world is the richer for possessing. This distinction between the framework and the central thoughts is especially necessary in the study of Spinoza, for the form in which his work is cast would seem to lay stress on their interdependence. It has often been said that the geometrical method was adopted because it was believed to ensure absolute freedom from error, but examination shows this to be a misconception. Spinoza, who had purged his mind of so many illusions, can hardly have succumbed to the notion that his Ethics was a flawless mass of irrefragable truth. He adopted his method because he believed that he thus reduced argument to its simplest terms, and laid himself least open to the seductions of rhetoric or passion. "It is the part of a wise man," he says, "not to bewail nor to deride, but to understand. Human nature obeys fixed laws no less than do the figures of geometry. I will therefore write about human beings as though I were concerned with lines and planes and solids." As no system is entirely true, so also no system is entirely original. Each must, in great measure, be the recombination of elements supplied by its predecessors. Spinozism forms no exception to this rule. Many of its leading conceptions may be traced in the writings of Jewish rabbis and of Descartes. The biography of the philosopher supplies us in some sort with the genesis of his system. His youth had been passed in the study of Hebrew learning, of metaphysical speculations on the nature of the deity. He was then confronted with the scientific aspect of the world as revealed by Descartes. At first, the two visions seemed antagonistic, but as he gazed, their outlines blended and commingled. He found himself in the presence not of two, but of one. The universe unfolded itself to him as the necessary result of the perfect and eternal God. Other influences no doubt played a part in shaping his convictions. We know, for instance, that he was a student of Bacon and of Hobbes, and almost certainly of Giordano Bruno. But these two elements, the Jewish and the Cartesian, are the main sources of his system, though it cannot properly be called the mere development of either. From Descartes, as Mr. Pollock points out, he derived his notions of physical science and his doctrine of the conservation of motion. In the fragment on the improvement of the understanding, Spinoza sets forth the causes which prompted him to turn to philosophy. It is worthy of note that they are not speculative, but practical. He did not seek, like Descartes, to walk with certainty, but to find a happiness beyond the reach of change for himself and his fellow men. With a fervour that reminds one of Christian, fleeing from the city of destruction, he dilates on the vanity of men's ordinary ambitions, riches, fame, and the pleasures of sense, and on the necessity of looking for some more worthy object for their desires. Such an object he finds in the knowledge of truth, as obtainable through clear and distinct ideas, bearing in themselves the evidence of their own veracity. Spinoza conceived as a vast unity, all existence actual and possible. Indeed, between actual and possible he recognizes no distinction, for if a thing does not exist, there must be some cause which prevents its existing, or in other words, renders it impossible. This unity he terms indifferently substance or God, and the first part of the Ethics is devoted to expounding its nature. Being the sum of existence, it is necessarily infinite, for there is nothing external to itself to make it finite, and it can be the cause of an infinite number of results. It must necessarily operate in absolute freedom, for there is nothing by which it can be controlled. But nonetheless necessarily it must operate in accordance with eternal and immutable laws, fulfilling the perfection of its own nature. Substance consists in, or rather displays itself through, an infinite number of attributes, but of these only two, extension and thought, are knowable by us. Therefore the rest may be left out of account in our inquiries. These attributes are not different things, but different aspects of the same thing. Spinoza does not make it clear whether the difference is intrinsic or due to the percipient. Thus, extension and thought are not parallel and interacting, but identical, and both acting in one order and connection. Hence, all questions of the dependence of mind on body or body on mind are done away with at a stroke. Every manifestation of either is but a manifestation of the other, seen under a different aspect. Attributes are again subdivided, or rather display themselves through an infinite number of modes, some eternal and universal in respect of each attribute, such as motion and the sum of all psychical facts, others having no eternal and necessary existence, but acting and reacting on one another in ceaseless flux, according to fixed and definite laws. These latter have been compared in relation to their attributes to waves in relation to the sea, or again they may be likened to the myriad hues which play over the iridescent surface of a bubble. Each is the necessary result of that which went before, and is the necessary precursor of that which will come after. All are modifications of the underlying film. The phenomenal world is made up of an infinite number of these modes. It is manifest that the modes of one attribute cannot be acted upon by the modes of another attribute, for each may be expressed in terms of the other. Within the limits of each attribute, the variation in the modes follows an absolutely necessary order. When the first is given, the rest follow as inevitably, as from the nature of a triangle it follows that its three angles are equal to two right angles. Nature is uniform, and no infringement of her laws is conceivable without a reduction to chaos. Hence it follows that a thing can only be called contingent in relation to our knowledge. To an infinite intelligence such a term would be unmeaning. Hence also it follows that the world cannot have been created for any purpose other than that which it fulfills by being what it is. To say that it has been created for the good of man, or for any similar end, is to indulge in grotesque anthropomorphism. Among the modes of thought may be reckoned the human mind. Among the modes of extension may be reckoned the human body. Taken together, they constitute the mode man. The nature of mind forms the subject of the second part of the Ethics. Man's mind is the idea of man's body, the consciousness of bodily states. Now, bodily states are the result not only of the body itself, but also of all things affecting the body. Hence, the human mind takes cognizance not only of the human body, but also of the external world, insofar as it affects the human body. Its capacity for varied perceptions is in proportion to the body's capacity for receiving impressions. The succession of ideas of bodily states cannot be arbitrarily controlled by the mind taken as a power apart, though the mind, as the aggregate of past states, may be a more or less important factor in the direction of its course. We can, in popular phrase, direct our thoughts at will, but the will, which we speak of as spontaneous, is really determined by laws as fixed and necessary as those which regulate the properties of a triangle or a circle. The illusion of freedom, in the sense of uncaused volition, results from the fact that men are conscious of their actions, but unconscious of the causes whereby those actions have been determined. The chain of causes becomes, so to speak, incandescent at a particular point, and men assume that only at that point does it start into existence. They ignore the links which still remain in obscurity. If mind be simply the mirror of bodily states, how can we account for memory? When the mind has been affected by two things in close conjunction, the recurrence of one reawakens into life the idea of the other. To take an illustration, mind is like a traveller revisiting his former home, for whom each feature of the landscape recalls associations of the past. From the interplay of associations are woven memory and imagination. Ideas may be either adequate or inadequate, in other words, either distinct or confused. Both kinds are subject to the law of causation. Falsity is merely a negative conception. All adequate ideas are necessarily true and bear in themselves the evidence of their own veracity. The mind accurately reflects existence, and if an idea be due to the mental association of two different factors, the joining, so to speak, may with due care be discerned. General notions and abstract terms arise from the incapacity of the mind to retain in completeness more than a certain number of mental images. It therefore groups together points of resemblance and considers the abstractions thus formed as units. There are three kinds of knowledge: opinion, rational knowledge, and intuitive knowledge. The first alone is the cause of error. The second consists in adequate ideas of particular properties of things, and in general notions. The third proceeds from an adequate idea of some attribute of God to the adequate knowledge of particular things. The reason does not regard things as contingent, but as necessary, considering them under the form of eternity, as part of the nature of God. The will has no existence apart from particular acts of volition, and since acts of volition are ideas, the will is identical with the understanding. The third part of the ethics is devoted to the consideration of the emotions. Insofar as it has adequate ideas, i.e. is purely rational, the mind may be said to be active. Insofar as it has inadequate ideas, it is passive and therefore subject to emotions. Nothing can be destroyed from within, for all change must come from without. In other words, everything endeavours to persist in its own being. This endeavour must not be associated with the struggle for existence, familiar to students of evolutionary theories, though the suggestion is tempting. It is simply the result of a thing being what it is. When it is spoken of in reference to the human mind only, it is equivalent to the will. In reference to the whole man, it may be called appetite. Appetite is thus identified with life. Desire is defined as appetite with consciousness thereof. All objects of our desire owe their choice-worthiness simply to the fact that we desire them. We do not desire a thing because it is intrinsically good, but we deem a thing good because we desire it. Everything which adds to the bodily or mental powers of activity is pleasure. Everything which detracts from them is pain. From these three fundamentals, desire, pleasure, pain, Spinoza deduces the entire list of human emotions. Love is pleasure, accompanied by the idea of an external cause. Hatred is pain, accompanied by the idea of an external cause. Pleasure or pain may be excited by anything, incidentally if not directly. There is no need to proceed further with the working out of the theory, but we may remark in passing the extraordinary fineness of perception and sureness of touch with which it is accomplished. Here, if nowhere else, Spinoza remains unsurpassed. Almost all the emotions arise from the passive condition of the mind, but there is also a pleasure arising from the mind's contemplation of its own power. This is the source of virtue, and is purely active. In the fourth part of the Ethics, Spinoza treats of man insofar as he is subject to the emotions, prefixing a few remarks on the meaning of the terms perfect and imperfect, good and evil. A thing can only be called perfect in reference to the known intention of its author. We style good that which we know with certainty to be useful to us. We style evil that which we know will hinder us in the attainment of good. By useful, we mean that which will aid us to approach gradually the ideal we have set before ourselves. Man, being a part only of nature, must be subject to emotions because he must encounter circumstances of which he is not the sole and sufficient cause. Emotion can only be conquered by another emotion stronger than itself. Hence, knowledge will only lift us above the sway of passions insofar as it is itself touched with emotion. Every man necessarily and therefore rightly seeks his own interest, which is thus identical with virtue. But his own interest does not lie in selfishness, for man is always in need of external help, and nothing is more useful to him than his fellow men. Hence, individual well-being is best promoted by harmonious social effort. The reasonable man will desire nothing for himself which he does not desire for other men. Therefore he will be just, faithful, and honourable. The code of morals worked out on these lines bears many resemblances to Stoicism, though it is improbable that Spinoza was consciously imitating. The doctrine that rational emotion, rather than pure reason, is necessary for subduing the evil passions is entirely his own. The means whereby man may gain mastery over his passions are set forth in the first portion of the fifth part of the Ethics. They depend on the definition of passion as a confused idea. As soon as we form a clear and distinct idea of a passion, it changes its character and ceases to be a passion. Now it is possible, with due care, to form a distinct idea of every bodily state. Hence, a true knowledge of the passions is the best remedy against them. While we contemplate the world as a necessary result of the perfect nature of God, a feeling of joy will arise in our hearts, accompanied by the idea of God as its cause. This is the intellectual love of God, which is the highest happiness man can know. It seeks for no special love from God in return, for such would imply a change in the nature of the deity. It rises above all fear of change through envy or jealousy, and increases in proportion as it is seen to be participated in by our fellow men. The concluding propositions of the Ethics have given rise to more controversy than any other part of the system. Some critics have maintained that Spinoza is indulging in vague generalities without any definite meaning. Others have supposed that the language is intentionally obscure. Others, again, see in them a doctrine of personal immortality, and taking them in conjunction with the somewhat transcendental form of the expressions concerning the love of God, have claimed the author of the Ethics as a mystic. All these suggestions are reductions to the absurd, the last not least so. Spinoza may have been not unwilling to show that his creed could be expressed in exalted language as well as the current theology, but his intellectual love has no more in common with the ecstatic enthusiasm of cloistered saints than his God has in common with the divinity of Romanist peasants, or his eternity with the paradise of Mohammed. But to return to the doctrine in dispute. The human mind, says Spinoza, cannot be wholly destroyed with the body, but somewhat of it remains, which is eternal. The eternity thus predicated cannot mean indefinite persistence in time, for eternity is not commensurable with time. It must mean some special kind of existence. It is, in fact, defined as a mode of thinking. Now, the mind consists of adequate and inadequate ideas. Insofar as it is composed of the former, it is part of the infinite mind of God, which broods, as it were, over the extended universe as its expression in terms of thought. As such, it is necessarily eternal, and since knowledge implies self-consciousness, it knows that it is so. Inadequate ideas will pass away with the body, because they are the result of conditions, which are merely temporary and inseparably connected with the body. But adequate ideas will not pass away, inasmuch as they are part of the mind of the eternal. Knowledge of the third or intuitive kind is the source of our highest perfection and blessedness. Even as it forms part of the infinite mind of God, so also does the joy with which it is accompanied, the intellectual love of God, form part of the infinite intellectual love wherewith God regards himself. Spinoza concludes with the admonition that morality rests on a basis quite independent of the acceptance of the mind's eternity. Virtue is its own reward and needs no other. This doctrine, which appears, as it were, perfunctorily in so many systems of morals, is by Spinoza insisted on with almost passionate earnestness. Few things seem to have moved him to more scornful denial than the popular creed that supernatural rewards and punishments are necessary as incentives to virtue. "I see in what mud this man sticks," he exclaims in answer to some such statement. "He is one of those who would follow after his own lusts if he were not restrained by the fear of hell. He abstains from evil actions and fulfills God's commands like a slave against his will, and for his bondage he expects to be rewarded by God with gifts far more to his taste than divine love, and great in proportion to his original dislike of virtue." Again, at the close of the Ethics, he draws an ironical picture of the pious coming before God at the judgment and looking to be endowed with incalculable blessings in recompense for the grievous burden of their piety. For him who is truly wise, blessedness is not the reward of virtue, but virtue itself. "And though the way thereto be steep, yet it may be found. All things excellent are as difficult as they are rare." Such, in rough outline, is the philosophy of Spinoza. Few systems have been more variously interpreted. Its author has been reviled or exalted as atheist, pantheist, monotheist, materialist, mystic, in fact, under almost every name in the philosophic vocabulary. But such offhand classification is based on hasty reading of isolated passages, rather than on sound knowledge of the whole. We shall act more wisely, and more in the spirit of the master, if, as Professor Land advises, we call him simply Spinoza, and endeavour to learn from himself what he sought and what he found. The two remaining works, translated in these volumes, may be yet more briefly considered. They present no special difficulties and are easily read in their entirety. The Tractatus Theologico-Politicus is an eloquent plea for religious liberty. True religion is shown to consist in the practice of simple piety and to be quite independent of philosophical speculations. The elaborate systems of dogmas, framed by theologians, are based on superstition, resulting from fear. The Bible is examined by a method which anticipates in great measure the procedure of modern rationalists, and the theory of its verbal inspiration is shown to be untenable. The Hebrew prophets were distinguished not by superior wisdom, but by superior virtue, and they set forth their higher moral ideals in language which they thought would best commend it to the multitude whom they addressed. For anthropomorphic notions of the deity as a heavenly king and judge, who displays his power by miraculous interventions, is substituted the conception set forth in the Ethics of an infinite being fulfilling in the uniformity of natural law the perfection of his own nature. Men's thoughts cannot really be constrained by commands. Therefore, it is wisest, so long as their actions conform to morality, to allow them absolute liberty to think what they like and say what they think. The Political Treatise was the latest work of Spinoza's life, and remains unfinished. Though it bears abundant evidence of the influence of Hobbes, it differs from him in several important points. The theory of sovereignty is the same in both writers, but Spinoza introduces considerable qualifications. Supreme power is ideally absolute, but its rights must, in practice, be limited by the endurance of its subjects. Thus, governments are founded on the common consent, and for the convenience of the governed, who are, in the last resort, the arbiters of their continuance. Spinoza, like Hobbes, peremptorily sets aside all claims of religious organizations to act independently of, or as superior to, the civil power. Both reject as outside the sphere of practical politics the case of a special revelation to an individual. In all matters affecting conduct, the state must be supreme. It remains to say a few words about the present version. I alone am responsible for the contents of these volumes, with the exception of the Political Treatise, which has been translated for me by my friend Mr. A. H. Gossett, Fellow of New College, Oxford, who has also, in my absence from England, kindly seen the work through the press. R. H. M. Elwes, 1883. A Theologico-Political Treatise, Tractatus Theologico-Politicus, by Baruch, later Benedicta, Spinoza. Preface. Men would never be superstitious if they could govern all their circumstances by set rules, or if they were always favoured by fortune, but being frequently driven into straits where rules are useless, and being often kept fluctuating pitiably between hope and fear by the uncertainty of fortune's greedily coveted favours, they are consequently, for the most part, very prone to credulity. The human mind is readily swayed this way or that in times of doubt, especially when hope and fear are struggling for the mastery, though usually it is boastful, overconfident, and vain. This, as a general fact, I suppose everyone knows, though few, I believe, know their own nature. No one can have lived in the world without observing that most people, when in prosperity, are so overbrimming with wisdom, however inexperienced they may be, that they take every offer of advice as a personal insult, whereas in adversity they know not where to turn, but beg and pray for counsel from every passer-by. No plan is then too futile, too absurd, or too fatuous for their adoption. The most frivolous causes will raise them to hope, or plunge them into despair. If anything happens during their fright which reminds them of some past good or ill, they think it portends a happy or unhappy issue, and therefore, though it may have proved abortive 100 times before, style it a lucky or unlucky omen. Anything which excites their astonishment they believe to be a portent, signifying the anger of the gods, or of the Supreme Being, and mistaking superstition for religion, account it impious not to avert the evil with prayer and sacrifice. Signs and wonders of this sort they conjure up perpetually, till one might think nature as mad as themselves they interpret her so fantastically. Thus it is brought prominently before us that superstition's chief victims are those persons who greedily covet temporal advantages. They it is who, especially when they are in danger and cannot help themselves, are wont with prayers and womanish tears to implore help from God, upbraiding reason as blind because she cannot show a sure path to the shadows they pursue, and rejecting human wisdom as vain, but believing the phantoms of imagination, dreams, and other childish absurdities to be the very oracles of heaven. As though God had turned away from the wise and written his decrees not in the mind of man, but in the entrails of beasts, or left them to be proclaimed by the inspiration and instinct of fools, madmen, and birds. Such is the unreason to which terror can drive mankind. Superstition, then, is engendered, preserved, and fostered by fear. If anyone desire an example, let him take Alexander, who only began superstitiously to seek guidance from seers when he first learnt to fear fortune in the passes of Sisis. See Curtius, Book 5, Chapter 4. Whereas after he had conquered Darius, he consulted prophets no more, till a second time frightened by reverses. When the Scythians were provoking a battle, the Bactrians had deserted, and he himself was lying sick of his wounds. He once more turned to superstition, the mockery of human wisdom, and bade Aristander, to whom he confided his credulity, inquire the issue of affairs with sacrificed victims. Very numerous examples of a like nature might be cited, clearly showing the fact that only while under the dominion of fear do men fall a prey to superstition, that all the portents ever invested with the reverence of misguided religion are mere phantoms of dejected and fearful minds. And lastly, that prophets have most power among the people and are most formidable to rulers precisely at those times when the state is in most peril. I think this is sufficiently plain to all, and will therefore say no more on the subject. The origin of superstition above given affords us a clear reason for the fact that it comes to all men naturally, though some refer its rise to a dim notion of God, universal to mankind, and also tends to show that it is no less inconsistent and variable than other mental hallucinations and emotional impulses, and further that it can only be maintained by hope, hatred, anger, and deceit, since it springs not from reason, but solely from the more powerful phases of emotion. Furthermore, we may readily understand how difficult it is to maintain in the same course men prone to every form of credulity. For as the mass of mankind remains always at about the same pitch of misery, it never assents long to any one remedy, but is always best pleased by a novelty which has not yet proved elusive. This element of inconsistency has been the cause of many terrible wars and revolutions. For, as Curtius well says, in Book 4, Chapter 10, the mob has no ruler more potent than superstition, and is easily led, on the plea of religion, at one moment to adore its kings as gods, and anon to execrate and abjure them as humanity's common bane. Immense pains have therefore been taken to counteract this evil by investing religion, whether true or false, with such pomp and ceremony that it may rise superior to every shock, and be always observed with studious reverence by the whole people, a system which has been brought to great perfection by the Turks, for they consider even controversy impious, and so clog men's minds with dogmatic formulas that they leave no room for sound reason, not even enough to doubt with. But if in despotic statecraft the supreme and essential mystery be to hoodwink the subjects and to mask the fear which keeps them down with the specious garb of religion, so that men may fight as bravely for slavery as for safety, and count it not shame but highest honour to risk their blood and their lives for the vainglory of a tyrant, yet in a free state no more mischievous expedient could be planned or attempted. Wholly repugnant to the general freedom are such devices as enthralling men's minds with prejudices, forcing their judgment, or employing any of the weapons of quasi-religious sedition. Indeed, such seditions only spring up when law enters the domain of speculative thought, and opinions are put on trial and condemned on the same footing as crimes, while those who defend and follow them are sacrificed, not to public safety, but to their opponents' hatred and cruelty. If deeds only could be made the grounds of criminal charges, and words were always allowed to pass free, such seditions would be divested of every semblance of justification, and would be separated from mere controversies by a hard and fast line. Now, seeing that we have the rare happiness of living in a republic where everyone's judgment is free and unshackled, where each may worship God as his conscience dictates, and where freedom is esteemed before all things dear and precious, I have believed that I should be undertaking no ungrateful or unprofitable task in demonstrating that not only can such freedom be granted without prejudice to the public peace, but also that without such freedom, piety cannot flourish, nor the public peace be secure. Such is the chief conclusion I seek to establish in this treatise, but in order to reach it, I must first point out the misconceptions which, like scars of our former bondage, still disfigure our notion of religion, and must expose the false views about the civil authority which many have most impudently advocated, endeavouring to turn the mind of the people, still prone to heathen superstition, away from its legitimate rulers, and so bring us again into slavery. As to the order of my treatise, I will speak presently, but first I will recount the causes which led me to write. I have often wondered that persons who make a boast of professing the Christian religion, namely love, joy, peace, temperance, and charity to all men, should quarrel with such rancorous animosity, and display daily towards one another such bitter hatred, that this, rather than the virtues they claim, is the readiest criterion of their faith. Matters have long since come to such a pass that one can only pronounce a man Christian, Turk, Jew, or heathen by his general appearance and attire, by his frequenting this or that place of worship, or employing the phraseology of a particular sect. As for manner of life, it is in all cases the same. Inquiry into the cause of this anomaly leads me unhesitatingly to ascribe it to the fact that the ministries of the Church are regarded by the masses merely as dignities, her offices as posts of emolument. In short, popular religion may be summed up as respect for ecclesiastics. The spread of this misconception inflamed every worthless fellow with an intense desire to enter holy orders, and thus the love of diffusing God's religion degenerated into sordid avarice and ambition. Every church became a theatre, where orators instead of church teachers harangued, caring not to instruct the people, but striving to attract admiration, to bring opponents to public scorn, and to preach only novelties and paradoxes, such as would tickle the ears of their congregation. This state of things necessarily stirred up an amount of controversy, envy, and hatred, which no lapse of time could appease, so that we can scarcely wonder that of the old religion nothing survives but its outward forms. Even these, in the mouth of the multitude, seem rather adulation than adoration of the deity, and that faith has become a mere compound of credulity and prejudices, aye, prejudices too which degrade man from rational being to beast, which completely stifle the power of judgment between true and false, which seem in fact carefully fostered for the purpose of extinguishing the last spark of reason. Piety, great God, and religion are become a tissue of ridiculous mysteries. Men who flatly despise reason, who reject and turn away from understanding as naturally corrupt, these, I say, these of all men are thought, O lie most horrible, to possess light from on high. Verily, if they had but one spark of light from on high, they would not insolently rave, but would learn to worship God more wisely, and would be as marked among their fellows for mercy as they now are for malice. If they were concerned for their opponents' souls instead of for their own reputations, they would no longer fiercely persecute, but rather be filled with pity and compassion. Furthermore, if any divine light were in them, it would appear from their doctrine. I grant that they are never tired of professing their wonder at the profound mysteries of Holy Writ, still I cannot discover that they teach anything but speculations of Platonists and Aristotelians, to which, in order to save their credit for Christianity, they have made Holy Writ conform. Not content to rave with the Greeks themselves, they want to make the prophets rave also, showing conclusively that never even in sleep have they caught a glimpse of Scripture's divine nature. The very vehemence of their admiration for the mysteries plainly attests that their belief in the Bible is a formal assent rather than a living faith, and the fact is made still more apparent by their laying down beforehand, as a foundation for the study and true interpretation of Scripture, the principle that it is in every passage true and divine. Such a doctrine should be reached only after strict scrutiny and thorough comprehension of the sacred books, which would teach it much better, for they stand in no need of human fictions, and not be set up on the threshold, as it were, of inquiry. As I pondered over the facts that the light of reason is not only despised, but by many even execrated as a source of impiety, that human commentaries are accepted as divine records, and that credulity is extolled as faith, as I marked the fierce controversies of philosophers raging in church and state, the source of bitter hatred and dissension, the ready instruments of sedition, and other ills innumerable, I determined to examine the Bible afresh in a careful, impartial, and unfettered spirit, making no assumptions concerning it, and attributing to it no doctrines which I do not find clearly therein set down. With these precautions I constructed a method of scriptural interpretation, and thus equipped proceeded to inquire, what is prophecy? In what sense did God reveal himself to the prophets? And why were these particular men chosen by him? Was it on account of the sublimity of their thoughts about the deity and nature, or was it solely on account of their piety? These questions being answered, I was easily able to conclude that the authority of the prophets has weight only in matters of morality, and that their speculative doctrines affect us little. Next, I inquired why the Hebrews were called God's chosen people, and discovering that it was only because God had chosen for them a certain strip of territory where they might live peaceably and at ease, I learnt that the law revealed by God to Moses was merely the law of the individual Hebrew state, therefore that it was binding on none but Hebrews, and not even on Hebrews after the downfall of their nation. Further, in order to ascertain whether it could be concluded from Scripture that the human understanding is naturally corrupt, I inquired whether the universal religion, the divine law revealed through the prophets and apostles to the whole human race, differs from that which is taught by the light of natural reason, whether miracles can take place in violation of the laws of nature, and if so, whether they imply the existence of God more surely and clearly than events, which we understand plainly and distinctly through their immediate natural causes. Now, as in the whole course of my investigation I found nothing taught expressly by Scripture which does not agree with our understanding, or which is repugnant thereto, and as I saw that the prophets taught nothing which is not very simple and easily to be grasped by all, and further, that they clothed their teaching in the style and confirmed it with the reasons which would most deeply move the mind of the masses to devotion towards God, I became thoroughly convinced that the Bible leaves reason absolutely free, that it has nothing in common with philosophy, in fact, that revelation and philosophy stand on totally different footings. In order to set this forth categorically and exhaust the whole question, I point out the way in which the Bible should be interpreted, and show that all knowledge of spiritual questions should be sought from it alone, and not from the objects of ordinary knowledge. Thence I pass on to indicate the false notions which have arisen from the fact that the multitude, ever prone to superstition, and caring more for the shreds of antiquity than for eternal truths, pays homage to the books of the Bible rather than to the Word of God. I show that the Word of God has not been revealed as a certain number of books, but was displayed to the prophets as a simple idea of the divine mind, namely, obedience to God in singleness of heart, and in the practice of justice and charity. And I further point out that this doctrine is set forth in Scripture in accordance with the opinions and understandings of those among whom the apostles and prophets preached, to the end that men might receive it willingly and with their whole heart. Having thus laid bare the basis of belief, I draw the conclusion that revelation has obedience for its sole object, and therefore in purpose, no less than in foundation and method, stands entirely aloof from ordinary knowledge. Each has its separate province. Neither can be called the handmaid of the other. Furthermore, as men's habits of mind differ so that they some more readily embrace one form of faith, some another, for what moves one to pray may move another only to scoff, I conclude, in accordance with what has gone before, that everyone should be free to choose for himself the foundations of his creed, and that faith should be judged only by its fruits. Each would then obey God freely with his whole heart, while nothing would be publicly honoured save justice and charity. Having thus drawn attention to the liberty conceded to everyone by the revealed law of God, I pass on to another part of my subject, and prove that this same liberty can and should be accorded with safety to the state and the magisterial authority, in fact that it cannot be withheld without great danger to peace and detriment to the community. In order to establish my point, I start from the natural rights of the individual, which are coextensive with his desires and power, and from the fact that no one is bound to live as another pleases, but is the guardian of his own liberty. I show that these rights can only be transferred to those whom we depute to defend us, who acquire with the duties of defence the power of ordering our lives, and I thence infer that rulers possess rights only limited by their power, that they are the sole guardians of justice and liberty, and that their subjects should act in all things as they dictate. Nevertheless, since no one can so utterly abdicate his own power of self-defence as to cease to be a man, I conclude that no one can be deprived of his natural rights absolutely, but that subjects, either by tacit agreement or by social contract, retain a certain number which cannot be taken from them without great danger to the state. From these considerations I pass on to the Hebrew state, which I describe at some length, in order to trace the manner in which religion acquired the force of law, and to touch on other noteworthy points. I then prove that the holders of sovereign power are the depositaries and interpreters of religious no less than of civil ordinances, and that they alone have the right to decide what is just or unjust, pious or impious. Lastly, I conclude by showing that they best retain this right and secure safety to their state by allowing every man to think what he likes and say what he thinks. Such, philosophical reader, are the questions I submit to your notice, counting on your approval, for the subject matter of the whole book and of the several chapters is important and profitable. I would say more, but I do not want my preface to extend to a volume, especially as I know that its leading propositions are to philosophers but commonplaces. To the rest of mankind, I care not to commend my treatise, for I cannot expect that it contains anything to please them. I know how deeply rooted are the prejudices embraced under the name of religion. I am aware that in the mind of the masses, superstition is no less deeply rooted than fear. I recognize that their constancy is mere obstinacy, and that they are led to praise or blame by impulse rather than reason. Therefore, the multitude, and those of like passions with the multitude, I ask not to read my book. Nay, I would rather that they should utterly neglect it than that they should misinterpret it after their wont. They would gain no good themselves and might prove a stumbling block to others, whose philosophy is hampered by the belief that reason is a mere handmaid to theology, and whom I seek in this work especially to benefit. But as there will be many who have neither the leisure nor perhaps the inclination to read through all I have written, I feel bound here, as at the end of my treatise, to declare that I have written nothing which I do not most willingly submit to the examination and judgment of my country's rulers, and that I am ready to retract anything which they shall decide to be repugnant to the laws or prejudicial to the public good. I know that I am a man, and, as a man, liable to error, but against error I have taken scrupulous care, and striven to keep in entire accordance with the laws of my country, with loyalty and with morality. A Theologico-Political Treatise, Chapter 1, of Prophecy. Prophecy, or revelation, is sure knowledge revealed by God to man. A prophet is one who interprets the revelations of God to those who are unable to attain to sure knowledge of the matters revealed, and therefore can only apprehend them by simple faith. The Hebrew word for prophet is nabi, i.e. speaker or interpreter, but in Scripture its meaning is restricted to interpreter of God, as we may learn from Exodus chapter 7, verse 1, where God says to Moses, "See, I have made thee a god to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet," implying that since in interpreting Moses' words to Pharaoh, Aaron acted the part of a prophet, Moses would be to Pharaoh as a god, or in the attitude of a god. Prophets I will treat of in the next chapter, and at present consider prophecy. Now it is evident from the definition above given that prophecy really includes ordinary knowledge, for the knowledge which we acquire by our natural faculties depends on our knowledge of God and his eternal laws. But ordinary knowledge is common to all men as men, and rests on foundations which all share, whereas the multitude always strains after rarities and exceptions, and thinks little of the gifts of nature, so that when prophecy is talked of, ordinary knowledge is not supposed to be included. Nevertheless, it has as much right as any other to be called divine, for God's nature, insofar as we share therein, and God's laws, dictate it to us, nor does it suffer from that to which we give the preeminence, except insofar as the latter transcends its limits and cannot be accounted for by natural laws taken in themselves. In respect to the certainty it involves, and the source from which it is derived, i.e. God, ordinary knowledge is no whit inferior to prophetic, unless indeed we believe, or rather dream, that the prophets had human bodies but superhuman minds, and therefore that their sensations and consciousness were entirely different from our own. But although ordinary knowledge is divine, its professors cannot be called prophets, for they teach what the rest of mankind could perceive and apprehend, not merely by simple faith, but as surely and honourably as themselves. Footnote. Although ordinary knowledge is divine, its professors cannot be called prophets. That is, interpreters of God, for he alone is an interpreter of God who interprets the decrees which God has revealed to him to others who have not received such revelation, and whose belief, therefore, rests merely on the prophet's authority and the confidence reposed in him. If it were otherwise, and all who listened to prophets became prophets themselves, as all who listened to philosophers become philosophers, a prophet would no longer be the interpreter of divine decrees, inasmuch as his hearers would know the truth, not on the authority of the prophet, but by means of actual divine revelation and inward testimony. Thus the sovereign powers are the interpreters of their own rights of sway, because these are defended only by their authority and supported by their testimony. End of footnote. Seeing then that our mind subjectively contains in itself and partakes of the nature of God, and solely from this cause is enabled to form notions explaining natural phenomena and inculcating morality, it follows that we may rightly assert the nature of the human mind, insofar as it is thus conceived, to be a primary cause of divine revelation. All that we clearly and distinctly understand is dictated to us, as I have just pointed out, by the idea and nature of God, not indeed through words, but in a way far more excellent and agreeing perfectly with the nature of the mind, as all who have enjoyed intellectual certainty will doubtless attest. Here, however, my chief purpose is to speak of matters having reference to Scripture, so these few words on the light of reason will suffice. I will now pass on to and treat more fully the other ways and means by which God makes revelations to mankind, both of that which transcends ordinary knowledge and of that within its scope. For there is no reason why God should not employ other means to communicate what we know already by the power of reason. Our conclusions on the subject must be drawn solely from Scripture. For what can we affirm about matters transcending our knowledge except what is told us by the words or writings of prophets? And since there are, so far as I know, no prophets now alive, we have no alternative but to read the books of prophets departed, taking care the while not to reason from metaphor or to ascribe anything to our authors which they do not themselves distinctly state. I must further premise that the Jews never make any mention or account of secondary or particular causes, but in a spirit of religion, piety, and what is commonly called godliness, refer all things directly to the deity. For instance, if they make money by a transaction, they say God gave it to them. If they desire anything, they say God has disposed their hearts towards it. If they think anything, they say God told them. Hence, we must not suppose that everything is prophecy or revelation which is described in Scripture as told by God to anyone, but only such things as are expressly announced as prophecy or revelation, or are plainly pointed to as such by the context. A perusal of the sacred books will show us that all God's revelations to the prophets were made through words or appearances, or a combination of the two. These words and appearances were of two kinds. One, real, when external to the mind of the prophet who heard or saw them. Two, imaginary, when the imagination of the prophet was in a state which led him distinctly to suppose that he heard or saw them. With a real voice, God revealed to Moses the laws which he wished to be transmitted to the Hebrews, as we may see from Exodus chapter 25, verse 22, where God says, "And there I will meet with thee, and I will commune with thee from the mercy seat which is between the cherubim." Some sort of real voice must necessarily have been employed, for Moses found God ready to commune with him at any time. This, as I shall shortly show, is the only instance of a real voice. We might perhaps suppose that the voice with which God called Samuel was real, for in the first book of Samuel, chapter 3, verse 21, we read, "And the Lord appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord," implying that the appearance of the Lord consisted in his making himself known to Samuel through a voice. In other words, that Samuel heard the Lord speaking. But we are compelled to distinguish between the prophecies of Moses and those of other prophets, and therefore must decide that this voice was imaginary, a conclusion further supported by the voice's resemblance to the voice of Eli, which Samuel was in the habit of hearing and therefore might easily imagine, when thrice called by the Lord, Samuel supposed it to have been Eli. The voice which Abimelech heard was imaginary, for it is written in Genesis chapter 20, verse 6, "And God said unto him in a dream," so that the will of God was manifest to him, not in waking, but only in sleep, that is, when the imagination is most active and uncontrolled. Some of the Jews believed that the actual words of the Decalogue were not spoken by God, but that the Israelites heard a noise only without any distinct words, and during its continuance apprehended the Ten Commandments by pure intuition. To this opinion I myself once inclined, seeing that the words of the Decalogue in Exodus are different from the words of the Decalogue in Deuteronomy, for the discrepancy seemed to imply, since God only spoke once, that the Ten Commandments were not intended to convey the actual words of the Lord, but only his meaning. However, unless we would do violence to Scripture, we must certainly admit that the Israelites heard a real voice, for Scripture expressly says, in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 4, "God spake with you face to face," i.e. as two men ordinarily interchange ideas through the instrumentality of their two bodies. And therefore it seems more consonant with Holy Writ to suppose that God really did create a voice of some kind with which the Decalogue was revealed. The discrepancy of the two versions is treated of in chapter 8. Yet not even thus is all difficulty removed, for it seems scarcely reasonable to affirm that a created thing, depending on God in the same manner as other created things, would be able to express or explain in the nature of God, either verbally or really by means of its individual organism, for instance, by declaring in the first person, "I am the Lord your God." Certainly, when anyone says with his mouth, "I understand," we do not attribute the understanding to the mouth, but to the mind of the speaker. Yet this is because the mouth is the natural organ of a man speaking, and the hearer, knowing what understanding is, easily comprehends, by a comparison with himself, that the speaker's mind is meant. But if we knew nothing of God beyond the mere name, and wished to commune with him, and be assured of his existence, I fail to see how our wish would be satisfied by the declaration of a created thing, depending on God neither more nor less than ourselves. "I am the Lord." If God contorted the lips of Moses, or I will not say Moses, but some beast, till they pronounced the words, "I am the Lord," should we apprehend the Lord's existence therefrom? Scripture seems clearly to point to the belief that God spoke himself, having descended from heaven to Mount Sinai for the purpose, and not only that the Israelites heard him speaking, but that their chief men beheld him, see Exodus chapter 24. Further, the law of Moses, which might neither be added to nor curtailed, and which was set up as a national standard of right, nowhere prescribed the belief that God is without body, or even without form or figure, but only ordained that the Jews should believe in his existence and worship him alone. It forbade them to invent or fashion any likeness of the deity, but this was to ensure purity of service, because never having seen God, they could not by means of images recall the likeness of God, but only the likeness of some created thing which might thus gradually take the place of God as the object of their adoration. Nevertheless, the Bible clearly implies that God has a form, and that Moses, when he heard God speaking, was permitted to behold it, or at least its hinder parts. Doubtless some mystery lurks in this question, which we will discuss more fully below. For the present, I will call attention to the passages in Scripture indicating the means by which God has revealed his laws to man. Revelation may be through figures only, as in the first book of Chronicles, chapter 22, where God displays his anger to David by means of an angel bearing a sword, and also in the story of Balaam. Maimonides and others do indeed maintain that these and every other instance of angelic apparitions, for example to Manoah and to Abraham offering up Isaac, occurred during sleep, for that no one with his eyes open ever could see an angel. But this is mere nonsense. The sole object of such commentators seems to be to extort from Scripture confirmations of Aristotelian quibbles and their own inventions, a proceeding which I regard as the acme of absurdity. In figures, not real but existing only in the prophet's imagination, God revealed to Joseph his future lordship, and in words and figures, he revealed to Joshua that he would fight for the Hebrews, causing to appear an angel, as it were the captain of the Lord's host, bearing a sword, and by this means communicating verbally. The forsaking of Israel by providence was portrayed to Isaiah by a vision of the Lord, the thrice holy, sitting on a very lofty throne, and the Hebrews, stained with the mire of their sins, sunk as it were in uncleanness, and thus as far as possible distant from God. The wretchedness of the people at the time was thus revealed, while future calamities were foretold in words. I could cite from Holy Writ many similar examples, but I think they are sufficiently well known already. However, we get a still more clear confirmation of our position in Numbers chapter 12, verses 6 and 7, as follows: "If there be any prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision," i.e. by appearances and signs, for God says of the prophecy of Moses that it was a vision without signs, "and will speak unto him in a dream," i.e. not with actual words and an actual voice. "My servant Moses is not so. With him will I speak mouth to mouth, even apparently, and not in dark speeches, and the similitude of the Lord he shall behold, i.e. looking on me as a friend and not afraid, he speaks with me. Compare Exodus chapter 33, verse 17. This makes it indisputable that the other prophets did not hear a real voice, and we gather as much from Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 10. And there arose not a prophet since in Israel, like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, which must mean that the Lord spoke with none other, for not even Moses saw the Lord's face. These are the only media of communication between God and man which I find mentioned in Scripture, and therefore the only ones which may be supposed or invented. We may be able quite to comprehend that God can communicate immediately with man, for without the intervention of bodily means, he communicates to our minds his essence. Still, a man who can by pure intuition comprehend ideas which are neither contained in nor deducible from the foundations of our natural knowledge must necessarily possess a mind far superior to those of his fellow men. Nor do I believe that any have been so endowed, save Christ. To him the ordinances of God leading men to salvation were revealed directly without words or visions, so that God manifested himself to the apostles through the mind of Christ, as he formerly did to Moses, through the supernatural voice. In this sense, the voice of Christ, like the voice which Moses heard, may be called the voice of God, and it may be said that the wisdom of God, i.e. wisdom more than human, took upon itself in Christ human nature, and that Christ was the way of salvation. I must at this juncture declare that those doctrines which certain churches put forward concerning Christ, I neither affirm nor deny, for I freely confess that I do not understand them. What I have just stated I gather from Scripture, where I never read that God appeared to Christ or spoke to Christ, but that God was revealed to the apostles through Christ, that Christ was the way of life, and that the old law was given through an angel and not immediately by God. Whence it follows that if Moses spoke with God face to face as a man speaks with his friend, i.e. by means of their two bodies, Christ communed with God, mind to mind. Thus we may conclude that no one except Christ received the revelations of God without the aid of imagination.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.